course.
Okay, thank you very, very much. First of all, I'm the last speaker. I will not take it that long. I will keep strict on my schedule. In Belgium, we called the last person the hekkensluiter, and hekkensluiter means the person who closes the fence. So I am the last one, and I have to close the fence today. I will tell you something more about the topic that is not touched in this conference up till now. It has to do with the context. So Judith's presentation is very closely connected, but it is the role of the government in the national governance of evidence-based practice. So what is the problem? Well, we have done a large study on all the Belgian activities on evidence-based practice, and that was in 2012. So in 2013, the report was completely ready, and we saw that the landscape of evidence-based practice in Belgium was enormously scattered. There were a lot of small organizations, small groups, universities, high schools, professional organizations, and so on. Well, and they popped up. In most cases, it was spontaneous with only their own financial means, and they worked on evidence-based guidelines, evidence-based instruments, and so on. So the landscape was very scattered. Secondly, the distribution of funding from the government to some of those organizations was not clear at all. The person who yelled the most, he could have some money, and others didn't get money. There were no real criteria, so that was also very difficult. It was very unstructured. The third thing was that that lots of instruments and guidelines were developed, but they were not implemented. The implementation efforts were very small and not successful. The fourth thing was that all those groups, they just stay on their islands, and there were only limited collaborations between the groups. So there was also an important point of improvement. And then finally, most of the funding for evidence-based practice in Belgium was for GPs, and there was almost no funding for nurses, for the midwives, and the rest of the allied healthcare professions. They didn't get any money. So there's in Belgium, and I think it was the same in other countries in Europe, but in Belgium it was really a problem, and there was a strong need to improve the situation. So the Minister of healthcare decided in 2016 that she needed a central governance system for evidence-based practice on a national level. She also demanded that there must be more emphasis on implementation. And finally, she asked for good quality guidelines that could be easily easily accessed by every health professional in Belgium. This is an example from the 2012 to 2013 study. These are all the fundings, all the sources of funding, and all the groups. So all the all the things like this here. These are all the organizations, and there were some chaos, unstructured ways of funding the organizations. These are the organizations, and the ones that are colored were the ones that developed evidence-based practice tools or guidelines. You see that some of them are connected, like here, and here, but others were completely alone. So the products that were made, they were often not distributed to the complete breadth of the healthcare professions in Belgium. So that was really a problem. And then the matter of dissemination, you see that a lot of organizations, they use their own channels to find the professionals, and at that moment there was not even a connection with the patients. So that was also a serious problem. What is this here in the middle? Well, some organizations, they had found each other, and they tried to set up one central dissemination channel for evidence-based products. Okay, so we started in 2016 in the Federal Healthcare Knowledge Center in Brussels with this. This is an ecosystem for evidence-based practice in Belgium, and it has six cells. Sorry, this is the life cycle, and it has six cells. The prioritization, the development phase, the validation phase, the dissemination phase, the implementation phase, and the evaluation phase. In every cell, there are some of those actors that I have showed you. There are actors who are specialized in development, others are specialized in dissemination, and so on. So in those cells were specific actors working on the same aim. Every cell needed a coordinator. So there were six coordinators. They have to work together in monthly meetings. They have to meet each other and to discuss problems, points of improvement, so on. Then in the center is the government. This is a steering group, and this steering group it contains all the funders and also someone from the cabinet, from the Minister of Healthcare. So this is the policy making and the financing group for evidence-based practice in Belgium. Then, for the first time, we also had a specific cell for implementation. So in those cells, only people work who are very committed and very expertized in the implementation, in knowledge translation, behavioral change, and so on. Then, another thing is that the circle is connected. It's a PDCA, a quality circle, and the results from the evaluation phase, they are used for the next years in the prioritization phase for new products, for improvements, for implementation projects, and so on. So there are two circles. The inner circle, the lighter circle, are the methodological processes for development, for dissemination, for implementation, and the ownership of those methodological procedures is from the cell. So the cell is owner of their own methodological procedures. The outer circle, the darkest one, are the operational processes and procedures. So these are very important to make a very smooth transfer from prioritization to development to validation, and so on. Okay, this was a conceptual model. This was our life cycle of evidence-based practice, but there was a need to build a governance structure around this process. Well, you have seen that there were a large number of organizations, entities, groups, and so on, patients and relative representation. So it was quite difficult. It is not that there are only two, three, or four groups. I think in totality, I think we had 52 or 53 groups that had to work together. That was quite difficult. And the minister also decided that not only the GPs had to be involved, but also 9 other healthcare disciplines. I've added them here: the nurses, the midwives, the dietitians, speech therapists, physiotherapists, the pharmacists, the podologists, and the occupational therapist, and last, the dentist. So there was a large broadening of the evidence-based practice system in Belgium. We questioned ourselves, do we need a top-down approach? Do we need a bottom-up approach? And who will take the lead of all those organizations of the... So that was also something we had to think about. Finally, we also found out that the involvement in the network is not the same as the commitment. People can be involved as stakeholder, but are they also engaged to work in the network? So that was also quite difficult. And another thing was that we had to do something with the input and the feedback of our system, because that's very important for improvement. Eh? What do people think about the output? Is it usable? Is it applicable? Is it so on? So that was also something we had to think about. Now, a very important thing is growing trust. All those organizations, they have worked together for 15 years. Some of them, and now they have to work together in one big group. So that was very difficult, and we were very aware that we had to build trust in the network. Okay, we searched in the literature, and these two guys here, Proven and Kenis, they are managers, and they have specialized themselves in the management of networks, sorry. And they say, well, there are in fact 3 kinds of network management system. The first one is shared governance. So no one is the boss. They work together. When there's a specific need, they find each other, they do something together, they go out and they start over with another one. So shared governance. Then the lead organization, that means that one of the groups takes the lead. It's very difficult because the leader here, he can manipulate a lot. So that's also quite difficult for a network to organize themselves. There must be a very high trust in this person. And finally, there's also the network at administrative organizations. That's a completely independent party that manages the network. Well, we have chosen for this one. And why? When you see the things like trust, the number of participants, consensus, and the need for network level competencies, and then the network administrative organization can be built with moderate to many groups. That is one. The NAO can be monitored by the members, so the level of trust rises. Okay, and also the goal consensus can be moderately high, but there must be a very high very high skills and competencies for managing the network. So we have chosen the NAO I've told you about now. Well, you can see it here. You can see the circle. You can see all the actors. And here is the evidence-based network administrative organization in the center. And there are two. Powers: the power from the government and the power from the stakeholder. So here is the power from the government. Here is the power from the stakeholders. When we go to the power from the stakeholders, we have set up a very important feedback system. Partly it's with ICT, partly by mail, by research, and there is also a feedback from the coordinators of the different cells. So you get back a lot of information from the system. Well, conclusively, at present, the Belgian the Belgian network for EBP is being operationalized. Huh? So things are changing now. We have first built our conceptual model. We have built in theory all the things that I've showed you here. And now we are working it out. Huh? So we see lots of organizations. We try to find a consensus, procedures, processes, and so on. The network administrative organization, it will be founded next week. So that's the second thing. The core business of the NAAO is being a central group that is specialized in communication, negotiation, informing, facilitation, and supporting. Building trust is very important. It's essential for such a kind of network, and we have to work on it every day with meetings, with negotiations, with mail, with newsletters, and so on. The consultation and consensus building and the negotiations, they are really crucial for the startup, but also for the next years, for the future. And most of all, the most important thing for me, I've worked for 5 years on it. In March, it will be completely operational. And well, I'm very proud that we have made it. For as far as we know, this is the first time in all the world that such a system is set up. So I'm quite proud. Thank you very much. Sorry, I am not a fluent speaker.
Jeff, thank you for a very knowledgeable presentation. Before you think the question, well, that's the comment here. It's amazing that the government actually gave you space of 5 years to prepare this. Our experience is that they want everything in 3 months, maybe two, and we have to still explaining, well, it's not possible to develop guideline in 2-3 months, which they want, or systematic review in 2 weeks, as we heard in a debate. Yeah, so it's amazing for us that actually you developed such, you know, great group and network in the Belgian. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations. So, questions from floor to Jeff. So, you still perhaps thinking about them. And, in the meantime, can you tell me what was the biggest challenge to actually get into stage where you are now? So, what you think was the biggest challenge?
We have had two very important challenges. The first thing was, and I go back a few slides to one of the first slides. There were a large number of funders, and we had to bring them together to make one lump sum of funding. And this is an history of perhaps 15, 20 years. So we had to negotiate, to convince them to put all the money together and start from scratch again. That was one. And secondly, all those groups, they have worked alone for lots of years. Now they have to work together. So building trust, that was also very, very, very difficult. And it took us weeks and months of convincing, negotiating, talking with them, going back, sending papers, ask for replies or for comments, rework it. But now we have a consensus with 90% of the groups. But that were the most important challenges up till now.
Thank you. So the last question of the symposium. Who would have the privilege? Seems that we will keep this to next symposium. Yes, okay, for opening question. So thank you very much, Jeff, for all your effort. Thank you very much.